Show. Hello, everybody. I'm Derrick Whiteskycloud, your host of Metis Matters Radio here in beautiful downtown, sunny, hot afternoon in Vancouver, British Columbia. Yeah, we're here. It's hot.
Javul!
It's hot.
Javul!
Yeah, Mark even says he's hot. Javul!
Javul!
This is funny. Thank you, everybody, for joining us on Facebook Live or in the chat room. It's wonderful to see all you folks in the chat. Please join us. And it's been a really busy week for me. I have been doing a lot of, upgrading in the Métis community. I've been running around, see what's going on in here in the community. And there's a lot of things that have been happening here locally because I've been so making myself so caught up in the eastern part of Canada. I forgot about my people. So I decided to do a little bit of research and do some things that are happening in our community that we have been so busy focusing on. And I know there's been a lot of identity. People are actually talking about identity change and who's going to be this and who's transparent and who's all that. Who should be your friend, who should not be your friend. I have been so busy what I decided to do a long time ago. I mean, I've been so focused for over a year or almost over a year, say over a year now, focusing in our own Métis community here in BC that I really didn't know anything about what's going on in the eastern part of Canada, like all throughout across Canada. And that's the reason why I thought, you know, I think we all Métis need to know what's going on in each other's community, because I'm sure a lot of people in Ontario have no idea what's going on in British Columbia. What we're doing here. I'm sure there's a lot of people in Nova Scotia don't even know what we're doing over here in BC. So that's the reason why I run Métis Matters Radio, because Mr. Ken Fisher, who was once the original host of the station, who's passed away, but when they asked me to come on board over a year ago, because they trust my work and the history of what we call Métis, you know, or Métis, sometimes people call us the Métis Indian or the half-breed or whichever you want to call us. You know, just don't call me late for dinner. And so basically, I have been doing a lot of, you know, self-promotion for myself as well as the community. But I also want to help out other musicians, authors, storytellers, other people in the community, whether they're presidents, chiefs, no matter what position they're in, even people of the community who have been concerned about their community. What's going on, and I allowed myself to get so caught up in other people's stories. And I'm not saying I'm against it or that I, you know, think it's a fault of my own. I chose this. And there's other radio show hosts that decided to, not just radio, they don't call it radio. Them, it's internet radio or internet. And they wanted their own little show. That's fine. That's fine. Okay with me. I don't mind. Everybody online has radio. To get them. Yeah.
Online radio. Yeah.
Online radio.
Yeah.
Well, they don't have, they're not under any kind of sponsor. They just do their own. But I've been doing it for such a long time, and I'm used to doing this. And I've done both for years. You know, I worked with another terrestrial station before this one. I've been busy with that one. Then I stepped away and did internet radio for the longest amount of years. And then I'm back here. I'm going to just go between both different kinds of stations. And I'm trying very much, very hard to understand from both sides. I mean, my job is supposed to be we're supposed to be talking about both sides of the story. If anybody's got a story to talk about regarding our Métis people, whether it's who's identified as Métis or who's not identified as Métis, I think a lot of people have forgotten that our culture wasn't, we never did go around and say who we are. We were just people, just having a life. We were people that are hunters, fishermen, trappers, I mean, whatever you want to call it, farmers, or even entrepreneurs. We've all had a job, right? How many Métis, pardon me, how many Métis talk show hosts do you know? Maybe 3 or 4, maybe 5 or 6. Not as many as most people know. A lot of Indigenous program directors would love to, you know, there's so many different people across Canada, across the world now. We're getting more well-known now than ever before. And that's a good thing, right? And I love getting out to reach out to everybody. And I'm getting a lot of emails from folks from the East now. They're telling me, well, Derrick, you want to hear, if you really want to be heard about what's real and what's not, I'll come on the radio too. Good. That's what I want to hear. But try not to comment me and tell me how to do my job. Because, I mean, I understand that you have an opinion. That's okay. And I love to work with everybody in every territory and everybody all part of Canada. Whether it's all part, and I mean, my ancestors go way back on my Indigenous side to Mi'kmaq, Ojibwe. Those are my ancestors, like my grandmother's from Mi'kmaq, Ojibwe. And she was taken from a reservation at the age of 10 and was adopted to a family and forced slavery as a slave servant. Now, she didn't know her identity, you know, as you expect it to be. She was forced to speak English, but sometimes they spoke Gaelic. So it was a mixture of her language plus Gaelic. You know, she did what she could. She survived. When she did, and then she turned 21, and then they let her leave. Now, there is no law nothing shown in Canada, in the eastern part of Canada, that they had residential school in Nova Scotia. And I know they did. But they never talked about the slavery to Indigenous people, the Mi'kmaq. They made that a shame, that you're not supposed to talk about it. And it was very wrong on their part. And I feel bad for everybody because, I mean, I'm supposed to be related because, I mean, I know the Chapman's family. That's my grandmother's last name. And a lot of it is partially French too. And yet I wasn't trying to chase my grandmother's identity at the time. I was just focused on just being me, you know, because there's my other ancestor side, which is my grandfather. And yes, folks, there is the real Pocahontas in the family. I mean, my grandfather is Robert Henry Rolfe, and his ancestor was John Rolfe, who married Rebecca Rolfe, who actually is the Pocahontas. Yes, folks, that's my ancestor. And I have documents to prove it. Now, my grandfather didn't go look for the documents. He was actually looking for his pension, just to get his pension when he was in his 70s, I believe. And this is back in the early 1960s, because I was like 8 years old. And I didn't know anything about it, but all I knew is after my grandfather passed away when I was about 14, I found my grandfather's, all of his identity, everything to do with his past. And it was in a black leather envelope, and I talked about this before. This is how I found out about my ancestry. This is how I found out how that got started. I thought, okay, pretty cool. We have an Indian in the family. We all, great. But then more started coming out when my grandmother, because she said that she also was from, originally from Bear River. But my mom and my grandma didn't make a big deal about it until many years later when my mom said, don't forget mom's side. Don't forget. And look, she says, you need to find it. So I did. And I was so impressed with my grandmother's ancestry and that I wanted to be, to honor her and all of our family. So, I mean, there's so many of us that have, you know, everyone would say that word half-breed does not sit well with us, but because we were slandered the word half-breed. And it, because it was there, you can say it in a negative way, or you can say it in a bad way, like in a good way. And in fact, there is a singer that sings a song called Half Breed, and well, more than one actually. And Cher did one, and another singer wrote another song. So I mean, we have so many different derogatory, as well, I guess you'd say identities, whether we are Métis Indian, because at first, you got to remember now too, folks, the word Métis did not exist. It was actually called we were called the Métis Indian. So that came after we just took that word Indian out because you want to have an identity. Just basically create the word identity. Now, if the word Métis Indian existed, just both words, then that means they would have been part of the First Nations group. And so there are so many different varieties of people that use that word, whether it's Métis Indian, or the half-breed. And, you know, I remember being called a half-breed or a breed when I was in school, but I didn't really think of it as being a negative. I was pretty proud of it. But again, everyone considered it, you look at it as being as an insult, but if folks feel offended, my apologies. But for me, I'm not offended because I take great pride in both sides of my ancestry. So same with our Métis, you know, you take great pride in both sides of your ancestry. Now, like I said before, there are so many things that have been happening in the community. A lot of people have been so caught up in it, they feel kind of like, and they're all fighting amongst each other at times, arguing, you know, not as much the word hate. Sometimes some people can hate. And I've been listening. I've been listening to everybody from all sides and even other shows and listen to those people. That's the thing. We're trying so hard to get the word out about an identity. Like, that's why we have Métis Matters Radio. When Ken Fisher started in 1989, Métis Matters Radio, because he wanted that word out. He wanted to get out there to let people know that Métis did exist. Okay? And we do exist. There's many of us for all across Canada. And now when the MNC came in and they decided to subdivide everybody, all of a sudden, we're being subdivided. Well, we're going to say, look, we're going to take a little bit of you. You're allowed this, a little bit of you. You're allowed that, a little bit of you. Okay. You can't be part of it because they're telling you can't be. Like, I didn't know all of a sudden they are the judge and we have to re-identify ourselves. And now we're basically called the forgotten people again. Really, because people are watching us from other areas of Canada. And they're saying, they're laughing at us. They're thinking that we're nothing but a joke, that we're fighting amongst each other. You don't see MNC and MMF actually saying anything. I don't get a call from them saying, can I come on your show? No, they don't want to. Because they already know what they can do and who they're going to affect. And they're going to affect a lot of people in Manitoba, as well as Ontario and Montreal and Nova Scotia, and you name it, every region, they're going to affect a lot of people. And they're going to hurt a lot of people. And they know it, but they don't care. All they care is about the dollar, that money, almighty dollar. And I remember one time when Métis worked hard, they were working hard to be to actually gather, you know, to bring in the herbs and the fish and the making the bannock, our favorite. Not fry bread, folks. Baked bannock, you know, and then they start teaching. How many people really know out there how to make their own food, like real true hunting food? Really? How many of you actually know how to do that? So I've actually noticed that when I watch the some of the things, some of the pictures and stuff that people have been teaching how to do the hides. You know, MNO was teaching this, and I was watching some of the pictures in there. That's fabulous. That's so great to see this, because I'm trying to promote what's happening here in BC. I seldom ever see anything happening in our community up here, so I try my darndest to make sure that what we can share with you from here in British Columbia compared to what's happening up in the eastern coast is way, way different. So I want to acknowledge everybody in our chat room, and because I see a lot of great people just acknowledging, you know, Gillette, La Fontaine up in Ontario. So, you know, on the beautiful shores of Georgian Bay, welcome. Let's see, who else we got? Oh, okay. Yeah, welcoming. Yeah, we're actually on the Coast Salish territory too. I want to also acknowledge you folks that we are on the Coast Salish territory. There's so many things out there that we've always wanted to do and make, you know, and acknowledge everyone. I'm very respectful for what I do in my community, you know, and this is something that I've always strived to do and teach that in a very good way and harmless, not harmful. So, and one thing I've always found is important is to promote a lot of our youth, you know, people that are wanting to get into any kind of industry, whether it's music industry, writing, you name it, any kind of business. I try to promote them as much as I possibly can, let them know what's going on, really let the public know that these young people really do exist and they're doing quite well. Before I forget, every Wednesday at the Friendship Center here in Vancouver, we also have the jigging practice and Métis dancing practices here at the Vancouver Friendship Center. And it's on from 5:30 until 7:30. So if you guys are in the territory, come on down here off of Hastings at the Vancouver Friendship Center and just go right through the door, and you will see can't miss it. You'll hear some jigging music, some fiddle playing. And even sometimes we do have light fiddle. So we actually everybody out there, and see who else we got here. Oh, St. Thomas, New Brunswick, Métis. See, we got Métis out there. Blondeau, Garpi, if I say it correctly. So we have so many of relatives and ancestors. Now, mine is Lajamondier. I have that in my family. So one of my ancestors is buried next to Riel. Yeah. And but I did not know that until many years, like I would say about 5 or 6 years ago, I was told about this, and that's my relative. And then I thought, oh, cool, that's cool. I got really happy with it. But, you know, you only say so much. You can do so much and say so much. Now, what we're going to do is I'm going to throw a song in, folks, because I want to acknowledge some of my ancestors and my old-time territory. And there's a song I want to play for you. So the song is called "A Manitoba Special" by Andy Jarlis. You listen to CFRO 100.5 FM Co-op Radio.
Thank you.
Dark White Sky Cloud. I am your host every Wednesday night from 5 to 6 p.m. for Métis Matters Radio, where we discuss why Métis matters and the worldwide matters of Métis people. From the past to the present, every Wednesday from 5 to 6 p.m. on Vancouver's Co-op Radio, CFRO 100.5 FM. Radio disclaimer, the views expressed and opinions given by the individual hosts and their guests do not necessarily reflect those of CFRO 100.5 FM, your cooperative radio network, and its affiliates or sponsors. Welcome back, everybody. And yes, you're listening to Métis Matters Radio here in beautiful downtown Vancouver, British Columbia. And yes, I am your host, Derrick Whiteskycloud. Now, I want to talk about something that actually was... I guess it's been passing around for the last, year. And that is, we're always talking about truth and reconciliation, because I remember myself when I was a young kid, I actually was part of residential school as well, back in Brandon. And, anyways, what I had was sent, this is quite interesting because this is actually based out of Winnipeg. And I'm not sure if all of you actually have read the story, but I'm going to share it with you today. And I think it's important that we need to share this for our listeners. Unmarked graves of children from residential schools found beneath an RV park. Campers have for years parked their RVs at the Turtle Crossing campground along the Assiniboine River in Manitoba, without knowing that it's situated on the site of an unmarked graves of more than 50 Indigenous children who died at the Brandon Residential School. But Anne Lindsay, a researcher and former activist with the National Center for Truth and Reconciliation at the University of Manitoba, has spent nearly 10 years looking for and trying to identify the bodies. And so far, she has identified children ranging in the ages from 7 to 16 years of age, dating back to the early 1900s. Now, the Truth and Reconciliation Commission found that more than 3,200 children in total died at residential schools, where more than 150,000 Indigenous children were sent from 1883 to 1998 as part of the program of forced assimilation. According to the Commission's report, child abuse was institutionalized at residential schools, and that the entire system represented an attempt at cultural genocide. Now, among its 94 calls to action was one to determine how and how many. Now, children died at residential schools and to determine where they are buried, but some say that so far all they've seen is apathy. We hear from residential school survivors who tell you of these things happening, of mass graves existing, and everybody always denies that those stories are true, said Arlen Dumas, and the Grand Chief of the Assembly of Manitoba Chiefs. Now, well, here is one example. Where will be more? Lindsay found the unmarked graves by using an old hand-drawn map made by a former student of the Brandon Residential School, current campground proprietor Mark Kovach, who is the third owner of Turtle Crossing, told CTV News that he had no idea his property held a burial ground. He said that he is cooperating with the city of Brandon and the local First Nation to uncover the grave sites. Their presence was to repatriate the bodies up to the site of the old residential school and to try and have a memorial up there. He said, harshly disciplined and poorly nourished, children at residential schools often died from illnesses such as tuberculosis, pneumonia, or influenza. But others died from the hard labor that they were forced to endure or died by suicide. 12 children died after Cross Lake School in Manitoba burned down in 1930. They operated equipment which in the early 1900s was far less safe than farm equipment we know today. Lindsay said they were also just physically run down from the amount of labor that they were doing. The Truth and Reconciliation Commission report said that the failure to establish and enforce adequate standards, coupled with failure to adequately fund the schools, resulted in unnecessarily high death rates at residential schools. The work of Lindsay and others in trying to identify the thousands of children who died at the schools is a difficult one. Now, in part, because the governments and churches have not always been forthcoming with relevant documents or have provided documents in poor quality, compounding the problem is that school officials routinely fail to report the deaths to authorities. Now, choosing instead to bury the children in unidentified cemeteries on school grounds rather than to send them home to their families. For nearly one-third of the deaths, no effort was made to record the name of the student who died. In even more cases, they did not record the cause of death. A meeting is scheduled in September 2018 to discuss the next steps, and Dumas hopes that Indigenous families long excluded from conversations surrounding the deaths of Indigenous children at residential schools will be invited. Now, that was in 2018. Now, my question is, I wonder what results did take place after 2019, because it's here now, and including the progress in moving and informing the families of the deceased children. You know, like, what did happen after that? I'm still curious what's going on, because the story, when I read the column, it was a very small little tiny column in a newspaper. Tiny column. Not a big story. Tiny column. I find that very wrong. And this should have been a bigger story than it normally was. And also, when they talk about children committing suicide, I don't believe it. I don't think any child actually was trying to commit suicide. Most children that I knew of when I was from Manitoba, most of them were running away. And I knew some of these kids that were running away, some of the McLeans and the Hools, I knew them. And, you know, I grew up with them, and they didn't try and commit suicide. Neither one of them did. There were so many horrific stories that there was even a guy that was helping to take care of the furnaces, and he was called a caretaker. And one really bad incident that happened was there was a boy that was being raped by the priest, and he forced all four boys to hold the boy down. And when the boy was fighting back and kicking his feet, the custodian and the priest grabbed him and took him downstairs into the furnace room and never seen him again after that. And we found out later that they threw him into the furnace alive. And those furnaces back then were much bigger. You know, you could throw logs in there and coal. So, and then they would say the kids ran away or committed suicide, which I didn't believe. There's no way. And so this is what happens. The schools did have money. They were controlling the children and were starving them to control them so they didn't have enough energy to run. So they starved these kids half the time. I know the stories because I'm part of the Truth and Reconciliation. I was one of the Métis that was there. But I wanted to share that story with you folks because I felt it was important that others need to know this. When I shared the story and when I read it, it got my attention. So I feel that if you are living in that region of Ontario or Manitoba, it is Canada's shame, and there's something has to be done about it. And I'm not hearing any more regarding this story, and I'd like to see more what did happen. If Dumas knows anything about it, if you know who this person is, I recommend that you contact this person and find out, because I like to find out what did happen. We have the same thing happen here in British Columbia. We have well over 300 children found in unmarked graves. Indigenous kids are part of residential school here too. So this is something that it's not, you know, it still is ongoing. A lot of it is kept quiet. It's considered, you know, they're trying to keep it hush-hush, and I know, you know, a lot of our government officials, they don't want to go any further with it. You know, and it does become a very heartbreaking issue, you know. So what I like to do is, I want to actually talk about this, folks. Have you guys noticed that there's more Indigenous women actually quitting their job working for Trudeau? Another one left today. Yeah, she up and walked because Trudeau, and this is what the ladies, the MPs with the that are also defending her, and they're saying that they witnessed, a whole bunch of them witnessed in the hall of the Parliament building, that Trudeau was yelling and screaming at her, calling her names, calling her down so badly that the woman was in tears. He yelled and screamed at her, just called her down, like, and then he calls himself a feminist? That's not what feminists do. Like, Trudeau, if you're a feminist, that's supposed to be what the word means, female. Are you a transgender or what? Like, that's not what a feminist is. If you really want to understand a woman's side, then you have to be a female, right? Like, come on. Like, the Prime Minister, Justin Trudeau, on Monday gave another spin to the revolving door of President of the Treasury Board, and it came that Joyce Murray, the Vancouver MP who had understudied the role as Parliamentary Secretary, she becomes the fourth person in a big chair since mid-January. After all the shuffling, however, the government still lacks a powerful Indigenous voice. Nova Scotian Scott Breeson quit the Treasury Board post January 14th, saying it was for family reasons. Ontario's Jane Philpott took his place but quit 7 weeks later because she couldn't stand Mr. Trudeau's treatment of his former Justice Minister, because of his former Justice Minister, Jody Wilson-Raybould. Vancouverite Carla Qualtroff, who also does public services and procurement, filled in as acting minister under the appointment of Ms. Murray. That makes four ministers, folks. Four ministers in 9 weeks, a head-spinning rate of churn. I mean, the Treasury Board is a central agency of government, policing the work of all departments to ensure that spending is properly authorized and departmental action conforms to law, government policy, and ethical standards. Since the cat has, in effect, been away since Mr. Breeson announced his imminent departure in December, Ms. Murray may find that the departmental mice have been gleefully at play since Christmas break. With luck, Ms. Murray will stick long enough to do the job, and that should help get the machinery of government functioning smoothly. An important gap remains. However, Mr. Trudeau's government used to include a powerful Indigenous voice like Jody Wilson-Raybould. Now it has none. Now, Canada has been pursuing reconciliation with Indigenous people in a general way for 30 years and in a very focused way since Stephen Harper. His government appointed the Truth and Reconciliation Commission under the Judy Murray Sinclair. 11 years ago, as part of the settlement with residential school survivors. 11 years now? Wow, it's been that long. I mean, I was part of it right from the very beginning. The commission reported in 2015, as Mr. Trudeau's Liberals were taking power, the appointment of Ms. Raybould was Justice Minister was an important step towards reconciliation. She was both a BC Crown Prosecutor and an important Indigenous leader. That appointment ended badly with Ms. Raybould's removal from Justice post in January and her acrimonious departure from the cabinet in February. The rights and wrongs of her quarrel with Mr. Trudeau had been picked over ever since. Now, the government, however, needs a powerful Indigenous voice now as much as it did in 2015. Ms. Raybould's saga so far seems to show that there is no place for a strong Indigenous leader at the top level of Canada's government. Mr. Trudeau and the leaders of other parties should not leave it at all. Now, according to the way we are reading it here, Trudeau is trying to remove anything that relates to the Indigenous out of his constituency. Now, the BC Métis Federation, they made a response on this, which is actually, the government, however, needs a powerful Indigenous voice now as much as it did in 2015. And Wilson-Raybould saga so far seems to show that there is no place for a strong Indigenous leader at the top of the Canada's government. Well, they're saying it's time to decolonize and indigenize government institutions where Métis, First Nations, and Inuit are decision makers at every level, real partnership. No more divisive partnership with national indigenous orgs like Métis National Council and tokenism. This is what they had made their this is their opinion. So there have been so many people out there right now today that are trying to still try and control the government. And the thing is now, Michael Warnock had left. And here is another person that I was really questioning, because I remember that one day that they actually recorded the video of him saying this. This is when the SNC-Lavalin scandal happened, but he kept on saying, when Judy Rabel, after she quit, and he says, you know, I basically stated, said, does Michael Warnock really believe someone in the cabinet is going to get shot or murdered over the SNC-Lavalin scandal, and why? Now, here's what gets me. Does that mean, do you think that he could have that it could have happened? And was that threats to Jody Wilson-Raybould? It makes you think twice. If it's fair to be safe to be a federal politician, is it fair to be safe? Do you think that, does that make you worry, nervous, if you want to become a federal politician, an MP, that is it possible that you're going to get shot or killed because you spoke up for the people of Canada? Think about it. This is SNC-Lavalin scandal has become almost like something to do with the mafia. Really? You think about it. You know, like, it's like saying, like, I got money for you here. You know, like, you might as well start putting cotton balls in your mouth and look like the Don.
Acting like war criminals, these people.
Yeah. I mean, it's crazy. So anyways, we're going to throw a song on folks. And yeah, Alex Carrier, and we're going to be talking, actually play a song. Nice one, nice waltz. If you guys want to get off your chair and do a little bit of dancing around with your partner, the Rocky Mountain Waltz, Alex Carrier.
So we can say the Emperor has no clothes.
Vancouver Cooperative Radio, CFRO 100.5 FM.
Yeah, what can I say?
Crazy, we're not corporate music. Whores. We're co-op radio.
Yeah. Cooperative. We're cooperative. Yes, folks, welcome back. This is Métis Matters Radio. I'm your host, Derrick Whiteskycloud, CFRO 100.5 FM. And it's a beautiful. It's actually, it's really sunny. You can see the, if you're actually in the chat room, you can see the sun just shine right through on the back window. People looking in like, what's that guy doing in there? You know, this is your typical.
I believe that's Mark from the next show.
Ah, yeah.
Mr. Mark Caron.
Yeah, he's coming on the next show after us. So yeah, it's actually a very interesting day today. And let's see, what's going on here? Somebody is actually saying, breaking news from the Alberta legislature this afternoon, new Alberta separatist party launches party with 60 candidates expected to run in the upcoming provincial election, includes placing priority, Wow, really? Let's see. Upcoming provincial election, including placing priority on First Nations and Métis Albertan first. Yay. Good, man. Thank you, Doug. Really appreciate it. Yeah, there's so many things happening out there today. We need to, it isn't really a value. It's actually absolutely important, folks, that we need to have a lot of our Indigenous people being a part of a government of an MP as an MP. It's important. We need to be part of it. And, you know, like, for example, our good friend and president of our BC Métis Federation, Keith Henry, when he's in the chat room, or if he's able to be in the chat room, he does call in. He'll talk about things that are happening in the community, which is, we find very important because this man's always busy. But also, him being just the president of the BC Métis Federation, he's also the CEO of an Indigenous Tourism Canada. And then so what he's doing is he's trying to promote a lot of our Métis, First Nations and Inuit history all across Canada, from across Canada, all across the world. So he's promoting us. So we are actually talked about all the time. And, you know, this is what I find is very important, because that's why we're here. And so I know Mr. Keith Henry is actually in the chat room, because I see his cool looking face in the picture. So he's listening in. I really appreciate that. And we do have a lot of things that are happening. Now, one thing I want to share with you as well. There's a lady who actually was doing her little talk about when Michael Warnick actually stepped down and basically saying he's going to retire. But Michael Warnick, actually, I really strongly feel the reason why he's retiring is not just because of Jody Wilson leaving. It's also because, apparently, what I understand, and this is an absolute true story, folks, his son, who also works in the government, works in Ottawa, tried to commit suicide twice and damn near did it the second time. So something's really going on. If they're saying that even, you know, Michael's son, Warnick's son, is even trying to want to commit suicide twice because he's dealing with the pressure from Trudeau. Something's not really good here, folks. You know, like, think about it. I don't know what Trudeau's agenda is, but he's doing everything he can to slip over and over and over again. I don't get this guy. Every time that he's ever told anybody that he's promised us something, he'll turn around and say, oh, well, I lied. Get over it. We're just going to move on. I lied. So what? I'm a politician. I lied. So what? Well, if you really want to keep on doing that, then you're going to end up turning itself into a new government, because we're going to have to become independents. And we will end up just kicking out the Liberals, and Liberals never come back. Period. You watch. It's going to happen, folks. There are people going to come in there, and they're going to start saying things. And they're going to start fighting for what's right. Now, coming up, we've got some really great people, and I've been promoting them right now. I want to do some music promotions. So let's see. Alex Carrier, who we just had on earlier from the Rocky Mountain Waltz, he actually is from his album Souvenirs. It's an old album back in 1964, 65 is actually when he did this album. So I transferred it from an album to the CD. The other new music that I've been receiving, let's see here, I've got Quinn Pickering, and he's got his new album out here, and it's called Baby Blue. And he's also a young Métis. He's 19, 20 years of age. He's also got his own band now. This young man is just kicking it up a notch. I'm telling you, he's doing quite well. If you guys are interested in wanting to get one of his CDs, let me know. You can always contact me if you have any other questions or any ideas, things you want to chat with regarding the show. You can contact me, MetisMattersRadio@gmail.com. This is Quinn Pickering called Baby Blue. That's his album. It's quite the album. But I got a surprise for you folks. Because we've got about a few minutes, but next week I'm going to have Charlie Fife on the show. But before we have Charlie Fife on, talk about him, but we're going to actually give away one of Quinn's CDs. So we're going to, yes, folks, one of Quinn's CDs will be a giveaway. So it's going to take you guys to make a little bit of an extra effort to call in. But there is a story to this. There's going to be a little bit of story because we're raising money for, like, I need to raise money for my program. And so we are later on in the future going to be doing a fundraiser to help keep Métis Matters Radio going. And so with your donations, we'd like to have you see if you can do a donation for Métis Matters Radio and Co-op Radio. And with that, we'll help promote our listeners, as our musicians, and so we can play their music, because we want these guys. These are independent players. These guys are not top 40 in someone else's station. We are the ones that are help promoting them, getting them known out there.
Independent artists.
We're independent artists. Yeah, and even Mark's an independent artist.
Yep.
Yeah. You know why?
Worked at a commercial station in Penticton in the early 90s. Was not fun.
Yeah.
Although it was one of the rare ones we actually picked what we played on the air, but it was only country, though.
Yeah.
But you learned about the good stuff sooner or later.
Yeah, I'm in the country.
Yeah, it was like the origins of the Garth Brooks era, which I didn't like too much.
I'm a country boy.
I was more of a Marty Robbins, Johnny Cash, Lyle Lovett, Dwight Yoakam kind of guy.
Okay, now the other one who we just got sent in, and that is a couple of weeks ago, another CD was sent to me. It's called My Songs for You, and the words and melody by Autry Combs and singer and rhythm guitar Debbie Harrington. Harmony, let's see. This is this band written by, this is another song, folks, that we, another CD we're bringing out. And those are in our Facebook chat where you get to see that. So if you guys are interested in anyone to order any of these CDs, let me know. You can always, like I said, write to me, MetisMattersRadio@gmail.com, and I'll get to them, or we'll see what happens from there. But this music is really good, folks. And I had a lot of fun doing it. And I love promoting people that are new artists. Another great friend of mine out there, and he's known up in Saskatchewan, and that's Jason Lapine. Like, this guy can play a fiddle like you wouldn't believe. And this is one of his CDs called Métis Flair. If you have never seen it, it's worth your while to get a hold of, as well as the other one. Jason, where are you, my friend? I got two of his. That's his latest one. That's his latest one. He sent that to me this past year, last year. That's his new release, Jason Lapine, called Métis Flair. And then his other one is that he did a couple years back in 2014, is called Driven Force, Jason Lapine. So again, we got some really great fiddlers. And then one of my really good friends is JJ LaValle. He's got his music, who I also promote a lot, because this guy is very talented also playing this music, so I like playing him. Let's see. I'm going to find some JJ or some Lapine. Let's see. Let's get some Lapine here. Lapine, where are you, my friend? There it is. Caribou Reel. Let's go to the Caribou Reel. Jason Lapine. CFRO 100.5 FM. Yeah, that's Jason Lapine. That's from his album, Metis Flair. That's a really good song. Just makes you want to jump up and go, yay! And play it again.
Like that. It jumped up and went, yay!
Yay! See what happens? You get caught up in it.
It's responsive.
It is.
It's actually showing response. Kind of reminded me of an old DJ I knew named J.B. Shane. He was introducing a band called Human Sexual Response. That was the name of the band, Human Sexual Response.
How about that one for a name of the band? Call your song Human Sexual Response.
By Human Sexual Response.
Yeah. Okay. Anyways, folks, we're almost getting to the close to the end, but next week, my guest will be coming in. His name is Charlie Fife. Not coming in, but he's good. We're going to have him on the show on the line. So he's up from Ontario. And those of you who may not know him, look up on the Facebook page. But we're going to have Charlie on next week. He's got lots of stuff to talk about. I've known Charlie for a long, long time. So looking forward to having him come on. And I think he's in the chat room. So we'll see what happens. We're going to have lots of things to talk about. Because I really want to get from his side, from where he is to what he sees. Like I said, when I tell people, we all have to figure out what we want in life. But also, we all have a voice and opinion to share. And I got so many people that want to write, that have it written to me and saying, I want to come on too. So we're looking forward to it. Anyways, folks, yes, JJ LaValle is coming up. Three men on a white horse. And I want to talk to you guys next week. Take care of yourselves and be good out there. Be good to each other. And we, see you guys later next week. Take care.